I was a stranger passing through your town. Yes, I was a stranger passing through your town. Hey, hey, I ask you a favor. Good gal, you turned me down. You may see me talking, walking down the railroad track. You may see me talking, walking down the railroad track. But good gal, you done me wrong. I ain't never coming back. It's the truth, honey. Holy,
honey, however, I'm my home.
So lonesome, I don't know what to do. Lord, Lord, baby, I'm lonesome.
I'll kill another
don't
route.
Know what to do.
Oh, people, that thought
the
I was a black sheep.
Me,
were you?
Well, I didn't think so. Oh, I never quit playing on you.
No.
Couldn't even play a guitar.
Well, I rode the Southern, I rode the L&N.
Every song has got a cream to it.
I rode the Southern,
and when you sing that cream, the L&N gets the chord. And I get the cream with the song.
And if the police
really meant.
Don't get me, I'm gonna ride them again. Tell them about me.
Do you remember listening to any type of blues when you were younger?
Well, I used to go, it used to be way back, you know, there used to be medicine men in wagons come on, sit on the street selling patent medicine, you know. And they'd always have a colored guy, he painted up like a colored guy, you know. And they'd have him, he had a guitar, and he always sang. And the great song was the Hesitating Blues. And it just went on and on, you know, and something like that. Well, I was born up in the mountain, I was raised in a den. My chief occupation, taking women from men. Tell me how long will I have to wait? Can I get you now or will I hesitate? They tell me that graveyard is a lonesome old place. They lay you on your back and shovel dirt in your face. Tell me how long do I have to wait? Can I get you now or will I hesitate?
Do you remember listening to the Grand Ole Opry, like WSM?
Oh, yeah.
Would that be a Saturday afternoon or evening kind of thing?
First night come on, 1925.
Really? You remember that?
Yeah. Well, me and three more people walked about that 2 mile half, that coal, walked on the ground. Yeah, the Grand Ole Opry night. Well, they didn't believe, one of them didn't believe it, that really come from Nashville. I said, this is what, 11 o'clock. And then I got him believing something was happening. There were a lot of people. Well, radio was scared because, well, people didn't have money to buy. Well, I just wasn't used to that change, you know. I got to singing then Jimmy Rogers. Jimmy Rogers come out in 28. He changed the blues. He changed the blues to something that could be. That's the change he made. He then became an American blue yodeler and the grandfather of country music. And he changed the blues. The black blues were just something you made up yourself. It never thing like that never could happen. But it was blues all right. But he changed it to the blues that could be, whether it ever was or not. And he started, and he made several hits with the Victory Record Company, but he didn't make no hits. But when he sung that song, Atifa, Texas, it went wide. It set afar, the world wide. And that's what made him a hit.
I said, Atifa, Texas, Atifa, Tennessee.
He didn't really invent it, you're right. I'd been inventing Sweet years ago, you know, the yodel one. But he made it unique for himself. The yodel was just a return. A lot of people guitar was that thing, but it was on a return. He would return with his guitar too. But he'd also return with a yodel. And every yodel had the same tune that that song did. T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Thelma, that made a wreck out of me. Yodely, yodely, yodely. If you don't want me, mama, you sure don't have to stall. If you don't want me, mama, you sure don't have to stall. 'Cause I can get more women and a passenger train can haul. Hey, yodely. Gonna buy me a pistol just as long as I'm tall. Hey, hey, hey. Gonna buy me a pistol just as long as I'm tall. I'm gonna shoot poor Thelma just to see her jump and fall. Yodely, yodely, yodely. Rather drink muddy water, sleep in a hollow log. Rather drink muddy water, sleep in a hollow log. Has to be in Atlanta, treated like a dirty dog. Yodely, yodely, yodely. I'm going where the water drink like cherry wine. Sing a blues, boy. I'm going where the water drink like cherry wine. 'Cause the Georgia water, they taste like turpentine. Hoodle-dee, hoodle-dee, yodel-dee. Hoodle-dee, yodel-dee, yodel-dee. I yodel-dee, yodel-dee, yodel-dee. You know, it's all like George Jones said now. This is real. It sounds ignorant, but it ain't. There's few singers. The world is full of singers. The world is full of good singers. But they're just really tops. They're a few tops. Because they got a way, and a different way. They may have a voice like the other, but they can't do it. They just can't. They can't put it out. That's all like Dave Meckham said. He said a lot of people know more than he did, but they just couldn't put it out. And that is true. And a lot of people may be a good singer, but they can't make it sound that way. And it's the music they got to go with. You take Merle Haggard. Now Merle got that honky-tonk music with him. And he's a good singer. George Jones, a good singer. There's a great demand for singing these days. Today I start loving you again. And now I'm right back, really where I've always been. What a fool I was to think I could get by. With 2 million teardrops I cried. The worst or the worst was yet to come. Fucking crying time for me has just begun. Today I started loving you again. And now I'm right back where I've always been. I got over you just long enough to let my heart ache, man. Then today I started loving you again.
About the jailhouse blues till you get within four walls.
No, you see, most of my time was in Prohibition. You see, Prohibition, I don't know what year dry Prohibition was before then, but and all of them was moonshine there. You know. People having little stills out in the woods cooking it, you know.
Did you have your own still?
Well, yeah. I ordered one, my boiler from Rex Supply Companies, Chicago, Illinois. I had it sent to Russellville, to the depot. And I didn't have it sent anywhere else. Oh, they call it that old Mountain Dew, and those that refuse it a few. I'll shut up my mug if you fill up my jug with that good mountain dew. Old Uncle Nort sawed off and short, measured 4 foot two, but he thinks he's a giant when you give him a pint of that good mountain dew. I didn't have it, though, man. People that refuse it, a few, that's right. Maybe they wouldn't take it from me, but they take it from you. And you could take a bunch of people and have a gallon of whiskey and drive them off in the river, following you with it. You just go in the river with that jug of whiskey and they'll follow you. Here's me, I said to a fellow by the name of Tommy Knight. I said, Tommy, you want a good drink of whiskey? He said, you know, I would believe I will wet my whistle. Oh, you just see people's face just draw, brighten up and you say anything about giving them a drink, you know. They'd come to your house, you know, and oh, they'd have a bush of coffee or something. I done a lot of walking. Come to Guthrie sometime, train wasn't coming to Elkton right then. I just get on the railroad, walk, come on Elkton myself, be train here, save 52 cents. Let's see, first car I ever had was, I bought it in 52, 53.
Yeah. Really?
50 model Ford. And it was a good car. I never had no car. When I was a boy, I mean, I was a guy to be a grown man, married man, I didn't have no car. I walked.
Oh, come hear my story of heartaches and sighs.
Of course, how come them here, they live in Virginia.
Okay.
And a lot of people left Virginia, everybody was going west, you know. Of course, they had to creek and go back across the ocean, you know, didn't want to go back. They just come back. And people was going west, and some of the people out there in Virginia went and was in Missouri. And they sent for them to come out there. Well, they got up and went out there, it's cold weather, on a wagon train. Well, they said they crossed the Mississippi River, thought it was old field. They pulled up that hog. And they got out there, all everything was watermelon. They didn't have enough. And well, and the one that sent for them to come didn't even ask them in. And they stayed here 7 weeks and eat hominy. 7 weeks. Then they stopped. They started back to Virginia, and somehow or another they're large here in Todd County.
Todd County, so you're born and raised
in Todd County. Never got too far away, but I couldn't walk back. Yeah, I had three sisters and one brother, one half-brother.
They're all gone to them.
All my people are gone, but me and Alexandria.
Where did you meet your wife?
Where did I?
How did you meet her?
Well, at church one night. They had a big deal, you know, and I was calling up on her and everything. She was standing back up by herself. She lived at College Spring. I walked up to her and I said, hey, y'all had y'all meeting? She said, yeah. Well, I said, she was down there visiting. I said, well, can I walk home? She said, yeah, I can walk home. Well, I was 18 then, and she was 20. She's 2 years old now. So, well, in 1925, November 24th, we married. Old Clarksville. She was done 21, but I was just 19, and I didn't want to get nobody that signed my license, so we just eloped. So I told her to go get write and tell her daddy to come after. And she did. And we stayed separate. We were separate in February of 1926. And then we went back together in 1930. And lived 55 years together then. Had three children. My oldest girl, she was afflicted. She broke her arm at school at 13, right here in 2. And she never didn't grow no more. A boy was young. The boy got killed.
What happened?
I don't know. But what happened to the boy, I don't know. He worked out here at the Harvest Moon, out here on 68. And so a call come out told me about 2 o'clock one morning. He was shot. And I said, who by? It's a Blake boy. And but anyhow, see, I didn't know things was like they was. I didn't know Mary Warner was as thick brown as it was, you know. And but anyhow, that was a bad place out there. Yeah. So whiskey, not legal. And Lindbergh Sears was the man that kept the hotel. Well, they come in one night about 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, the coroner and the undertaker there. That was a little unusual too, you know. And well, they knocked on the door. And what y'all want? Said, well, David got shot. Well, left me there. I said, well, was he dead? Is he dead? Said, oh yeah, he's dead. Said, got shot about 11 o'clock. All that time now before they called me, you see. That didn't make sense. And they come out there, they didn't call me, they come out there and let me know about 2 o'clock. And something going on between 11 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And and I said, well, who shot him? He told me it was Blake Boyd. I said, what with? Said, a 357 Magnet. Well, I didn't know. I didn't know why. I just, well, all the rest of them, yeah, he got shot, you know. Well, after the thing was kind of over, I went out there. He shot from the window outside. Down in the car, and the window was up pretty high where you had to reach. So, man drove up out in the car and said, David went to the window and he come and thought it was a customer, you know, and he shot him. And straight through, right through here. Well, I went out there investigating one day. Man drove up out to the window to get some liquor. I said, you reach my hand, yeah, out of your car. Well, he had to reach up. I had to reach down. He said, what are you doing? I said, oh, I'm just fooling around. And I said, where's the blood stain here on the concrete here? Oh, they said, we washed it up. And they burned. I mean, no, that wouldn't do either. Because you can't wash up bloodstain. Then the next day, another man went up and had a carpet on the floor. I don't know about it. Had a lot going on them days. A lot of money swinging around. You know, where a lot of money at? Bound to be a little bit out of it. Something else going on.
Really?
In May. I forgot the date. The day of the month. 1935.
Were you at
66 years ago. It's last month.
At a revival, or how did it
no, happen? No, out in the field.
In the field?
I went to a man, see what to do. Another man out there, fencing. He's supposed to be a preacher. I went to him, and he said, well, I said, we'll go down in the woods and pray. About that time, I said, Lim, in the name of Lim. I said, Lim, the Lord has saved me. And he threw that hammer up. He had a nailing war to the pole. He threw that hammer up, and he told me he never did find that hammer. And I remember seeing that hammer going up. I caught for 32 years. And I worked in rockwares and cut a lot of timber.
Mm-hmm.
Back in them days, we done it with crosscut saws and didn't have thousands. But we all made a living. You can take mules now and horses and make a living for the population. I remember when they went to the corn drill, one row corn drill. What would one row of corn in the 200 or 300 field making corn now for the people? It wouldn't work. Some says you, we're going back to where we were. Oh, I said, no, you can't go back. You got to go on. That stalk of corn you plant, it died. It never comes to life. The other corn goes up, but it stands alone and turns yellow. That's all there are to it. If you don't prosper, you die. W-H-Y is a great word. If you don't know the why, you ain't got much story. A whole lot of things that goes around just heard. I heard it. My granddaddy heard it. Religion is kind of like politics. If your daddy and mother was a Democrat,
then that's right, and there's no other way.
And no other way. Mm-hmm. And if they were Republican, and no other way.
No other way.
And so, it's all the same, you know, anyhow. But there's so many ideas, different ideas. Look at the churches there are in the world. All of them different.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this looked me like any man with one eye, half cent, could see all of them couldn't be true. There's just one truth. 50 years from now, people be wondering how these people in the 2000.
Right. I agree with you there, because you, no matter where you're at, you think that you're at the height of technology and advancement, but...
You see, the advance is what people really don't understand. It's more for the benefit of the people. Now, when we didn't have no cars, I remember there was no car in the country. And all of that. Well, people were going walking, horseback, wagon, buggy, going places, you know. Well, that was seemed like a good time. But they had never experienced these times. I don't know what they'd be going in. The wall telephones is gone. There'd be In a few years, there won't be no wall telephone or no desk telephone. It just has that and that little telephone you carry in your pocket.
Right.
Why not? Well, what would you want? How expensive cables and things? And you just take a little box here and talk all over the world without any walls. That telephone, that television, 9-20 years from now, I don't know what you'd be looking at, but you won't be looking at television. It'd be something else.
You're right.
Because
exactly right.
Somebody's inventing something all the time, you see. But I never was a hard worker. I just kind of like the word hobo. I like to be free. I got an old slouch hat. Got my roll upon my shoulder. I'm free as a breeze. I'll do as I please. Bumming around. I got a million friends. I don't feel any older. I've nothing to lose, not even the blue. Just bumming around. When worry starts to bothering me, I grab my coat, my old slouch hat, and hit the trail again, you see. I haven't got a dime. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm free as a breeze. I do as I please. Just bumming around. I like that.
I like that one.